Thank you very much, Charlie. When I was told the other day that this job does come with a gavel, I told Nina, I said, well, I certainly hope I never have to use it during my year, and I don't expect to. I also want to thank Charlie and the outgoing board for a tremendous year of activity in the club. I want to pledge to every one of you here and to the entire membership that our mission is to continue to carry out the mission of the club. And I don't know that we've read the mission very often. It's only one sentence, and I thought I might read it again because it really states what we're all about. The mission is to provide a common meeting ground for congenial, forward-looking persons of divergent beliefs, politics, and occupations, for the interchange of ideas and stimulation of intelligent thinking on civic matters, and to inform its members and the community in public matters, and to arouse in them an appreciation of the obligations of citizenship. The outgoing board and the new board revisited this mission statement last Tuesday evening in a long sort of mini retreat. We didn't make any changes in it, but we did make some commitments, and the commitments are along the lines of maintaining our outstanding Friday programs, making sure that the City Club continues to be the forum in the city, if not the entire state, to involve as many members as we possibly can in the standing committees and the other committee work of the club, to continue the excellent work in our research studies, and to make sure that we adequately address the current and important issues of the day, to continue to study and bring to the membership selected ballot measures, and we'll have some of those, of course, coming this fall. And finally, to continue to maintain the sound financial condition of our club. That's our commitment. We have a fine board, and I'm really looking forward to working with them for the coming year. Our board host for today, which comes with the opportunity to ask the first question, will be our president-elect, Bill Lesh. Television is called a medium, perhaps because so little of it is rare and so little of it perhaps is well done. But love it or hate it, we must admit that it's a force that's had an unequaled impact on the way we perceive the events of the world, on the way our children grow, on our households, etc. I think it's fitting, then, that our annual meeting during this election year is dedicated to a look at television and its effect, particularly on the political process. The last 8 years have been influenced and dominated perhaps by an administration in Washington that was keenly aware of the importance of television, but perhaps was not always successful in presenting the picture that it wanted. As we look toward the election of a new president, we know that the selection process itself will perhaps at times become indistinguishable almost from the media coverage. The City Club is honored today to have one of Northwest's most knowledgeable and respected commentators to share his thoughts on the role of television. Jim Compton is a native Oregonian and attended Reed College. He later spent time in Romania on a Fulbright scholarship. As an NBC television correspondent, John was assigned to the Middle East and London bureaus, reporting from Africa, Europe, the Soviet Union, other Eastern Bloc countries, as well as many Arab nations. He covered the 1982 Israeli invasion of Lebanon and reported on the Iraq-Iran war. He provided U.S. viewers with coverage of the Iranian Revolution from Tehran. Today, Mr. Compton offers commentary on KING TV in Seattle. He hosts the weekly Compton Report, which you see in Portland on Sunday mornings at 8:30. Each week, he interviews guests on regional and national public affairs questions. I'm honored then to introduce to you Jim Compton, who will talk to us about TV's potential in framing the political debate. John.
Let me by way of telling you my terms, I am an imposter because I don't understand television. I think that we have to deal with it, and it is an institution whose effects are so broad that it really defies any simple explanation. It's like trying to describe science to you to describe television. What is useful, I think, is to try to focus attention on the role that television today has in social and political change, and the way that it is changing our behavior, the way it has come to frame the agenda in this society. The power, the pervasiveness of the medium are awesome. We all know that. I don't think that's either good or bad. My point of view is that it is simply a key fact that we have to deal with in understanding and operating in American society. And I want to alert you to some trends that I've read about or know about in a medium that, as I confess, we professional television people don't even understand very well. Television has the power to influence these things. Who gets into public office and why? Right or wrong, it influences what people think is important. It influences the decisions you make about public officials, and often it is the reason you find them so disappointing. It has put complex new restraints, sometimes very much for the good, on public officials. But behind all of this are the dynamics of money in television at the network and the local level. So what I want to frame for you, if I can, is a series of paradoxes, really, that television we all recognize as having the potential to be a great force for good in this society, to make us an informed democracy. At the same time, we can all easily think of examples when it's a mindless showbiz medium that does not merit our respect. There's truth to both those positions. Not quite 20 years ago, on October the 25th, 1968, Bob Packwood debated Wayne Morse on this platform. And the outcome we know, a senior U.S. senator, 24 years of seniority in the U.S. Senate, was defeated. And I maintain that TV was one of the reasons. Part of the agenda of television these days is that you can only be one person. And Wayne, we know, was an accomplished orator who could go down to the Longshoremen's Hall and give them hell, and a few hours later do another more abstract, intellectual kind of speech to the Chamber of Commerce. But he didn't fully appreciate the penetrating scrutiny that television puts on performance. He could not homogenize his oratory, and he paid for it by losing the Senate seat. The people of Oregon were given a choice between the garish bombast of Wayne Morse, and I was an admirer of his, by the way, and the modest, well-spoken state legislator named Bob Packwood, and we know who they chose. Television today imposes a requirement that you address more people simultaneously. That's a simple fact. But for good or bad, it is forcing consistency on public officials. Another way it's shaping the debate is through its growing monopoly, and I think its alarming monopoly, of the information that you get about almost everything. The major national newspapers, the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, the Post, USA Today, have circulations of about 1 to 3 million daily. But each of the national networks has audiences of 12 to 15 million people every night. And the surveys tell us that 2/3 of Americans now view television as their principal source of information on international, national, and local news. Well, why is that? The surveys tell you something else. People think television is more credible. I don't fully understand that. The Roper poll asked this question a couple of years ago. If conflicting versions of the same events were reported, who would you believe? 53% said television, 22% said newspapers. It makes sense in that everything about TV is more vivid, it is more intense, it's more emotional. And that's not bad. I maintain that there are some issues that would never have come into the public arena if not for that. The ability of TV to energize them. Foreign policy issues are one. You cannot turn to the next page when Tom Brokaw starts talking about the INF Treaty. And when he shows you those missiles taking off, it's different from reading about those missiles in the Oregonian. So in this country, we have 80 to 100 million people watching television between 8 and 11 o'clock every night. And the important thing to recognize is that it's no longer discretionary. You know, when you want to go to a play or a movie, you have to get in the car and you have to make some conscious decisions about it. TV has become a part of our furniture. It's become part of the natural flow of things. And to a politician, what this means is that aside from being judged on their record or on the issues that they espouse or on their the positions they've taken, it means that manipulating their image on the television screen becomes the central thing they have to do to collect votes, to be elected to office, and to govern. Lloyd Cutler, who was an aide to Jimmy Carter, he was chief counsel in the Carter years in the White House, said, learning to adjust to TV is central to the art of governing today. Well, how does that work? There's a very good book about this by a guy named Joshua Myrowitz at the University of New Hampshire. It's called No Sense of Place, and it's a kind of a difficult treatise about the rhetoric of television, but he makes some very penetrating points. He says that TV has knocked down all the walls in our environment. There's no longer a front stage and a backstage to our behavior, so that our intellectual lives no longer are limited by social boundaries, and they're certainly not limited by physical barriers of place or distance. You can sit in your living room and you can see Tom Brokaw talking with Gorbachev inside the Kremlin. So that's a way that TV alters the way we behave. In other words, we're forced to interact, whether we like it or not, with new issues, with new situations, and people that were never a part of our life. We can no longer isolate ourselves from famine in Africa. We can not isolate ourselves from Gary Hart's private life. I never wanted to know all that about his private life, but the locker room language of Richard Nixon in the White House, the racism of the American South when the Civil Rights Movement began. I would argue that the television has brought us towards new tolerance and new understanding of people around us. It's harder to contemplate going to war with the Soviet Union after what we saw this week from the summit. Those people have been given a kind of a flesh and blood reality that I think would make it harder to shoot at them. And I think that in spite of the criticism of this summit, that it's been largely symbolic, that's symbolic is not bad. Symbolic means that we're talking to them. And we're forced now to deal with issues that were previously taboo, like incest, like homosexuality. TV has forced issues out of the closet and forced us to debate them. And in some cases, I'd argue that we have gained a real tolerance of alternative lifestyles because of television. Myrowitz goes on and spins out a theory about what television means in terms of American political behavior. He says, why are we constantly bombarded with the theme about the decline of greatness in people seeking public office? The troubled presidency, Nixon resigning in disgrace, Jerry Ford rejected by the voters because he couldn't walk and chew gum at the same time, Jimmy Carter rejected by his party and the electorate. Myrowitz argues it's not just the presidency, it is public figures in general who have had the calculated or the contrived images that they tried to project. They've had those images stripped away. Let me quote him again. He says, when access was limited, that is when we couldn't see everything about a person's life, we didn't go backstage. Wayne Morris could give him hell in a union hall and then later the same day give a calm speech about the Constitution in Dunthorpe. I don't know, Wayne Morris probably would never have been invited to Dunthorpe, but that's the point is that you could be more than one person in the old days. Franklin Roosevelt could prevent the media ever seeing his awful paralysis. And what we saw instead was the jaw and the cigarette holder and this generation has a rendezvous with destiny. Poor Jerry Ford bumped his head, slipped on the steps of the airplane, and the cameras were running. And he became a laughingstock, so that the myths are not possible any longer, just human reality in the age of television. Jimmy Carter and all his populist zeal to tell all shared his hemorrhoid operation with the American people, and it did not add majesty to his presidency. But TV has not operated in the ways that we feared. In other words, there was a time when we thought that people with rhetorical skills or polished images or good looks would have the key to the White House in the age of television. Arthur Schlesinger wrote recently that candidates in the TV age, and he uses Lyndon Johnson, Richard Nixon, Walter Mondale, are hardly a bunch of bathing beauties. But what is really telling about Schlesinger's point is that the people you think are the telegenic personalities, John Lindsay, mayor of New York, everybody thought he'd be president, right? John Connolly, fantastic profile. Now Al Gore, they're all flops on television, or they are all flops at the polls. And I think this is a secret to part of TV's strength. The TV looks inside those candidates in ways that newspapers can't do. Television may be, and probably is, second rate at examining their stands on issues, but it gives us very penetrating insights into their personality and their character. So how do we explain Ronald Reagan and his appeal? Well, television X-rayed him, and it showed the American people, I think, a fundamentally decent man who wanted to restore national pride and prestige, and that was a perfect fit with the way people felt at that time, and the issues didn't matter. Television's flaw is that it is weak on forcing attention on issues and positions, but I would argue it does a bang-up job of telling us about all the warts and blemishes of personality. A researcher in California tried to factor out how the television message is perceived. And I don't know whether I buy this or not, but it's fascinating. He argues that it's 7% verbal, that's the literal content, 38% vocal and inflection, and 55% is perceived through facial expression and posture. And that's how we read the screen these days. So TV has penetrating eyes. Is that a blessing or is it a curse? Well, I think it's neither, of course. It is simply the new environment in which we have to conduct our lives. The trouble is that there's tremendous potential to manipulate the medium because of that. And there's a wonderful story told by Martin Schramm, who's a reporter for the Rocky Mountain Gazette. He used to be at the White House for Newsday. He wrote a book called The Great American Video Game. And the story is that Leslie Stahl, who was then the CBS White House correspondent, tried to do a piece about how the Reagan White House, and this was in the 84 campaign, was using television images to contradict or to neutralize the policy positions that the president was taking. So, for example, he had proposed cutting the budget for the handicapped. The White House managed to get pictures taken of the president presiding at the handicapped Olympics. He had proposed cutting federal housing subsidies for the elderly, but at the same time he was pictured dedicating a senior citizen center. Well, so Leslie Stahl did a piece to try to explain to you viewers how that the dynamics of that. She did a 6-minute piece, which is very long for network television, on CBS, showing how the images tried to erase negative impressions of presidential policy. And she thought it was a bang-up, hard-hitting piece of journalism. And Schramm tells in his book how, when it was over, she sat in her darkened office in the West Wing of the White House and waited for the phone to ring, and it did. And it was the White House press secretary saying, "They loved your piece." And they said, 6 minutes of wonderful pictures of the president, and if the pictures are great, the public never hears what you're saying. And that's the conundrum of covering the White House. And the real paradox, in a way, is that the electronic, that we in electronic journalism don't understand the rhetoric of our own medium as well as the politicians do. There's another way that I think television is shaping the debate, and probably for the worse, and that's in the official conduct of foreign affairs. In those 444 days that the Americans were held in the embassy in Tehran, television magnified and exaggerated the torment and the political potency of that event. The networks were there, and we heard about nothing else. And I believe that the drumbeat of coverage from the three networks probably made any kind of quiet negotiation impossible. Lloyd Cutler, again, who was White House counsel for Carter during those years, said the most harmful effect of television is that it speeds up the decision-making process. It accelerates the way the things that presidents have to do. He gives a wonderful example. The KAL airline was shot down by the Soviets. And of course, the press must respond to that by trying to get the president's reaction. They were clamoring outside the Oval Office, what are we going to do about this? The initial intelligence conclusion that came to the president was that the Soviets knew that they were tracking a commercial airliner, and they shot anyway. And so Reagan went on television, and he said, cold-blooded murder by the Soviet Union. Well, of course, the facts came out later that the Soviets probably had mistaken the plane for an electronic eavesdropping flight. But the effect is so dangerous, that the effect of exaggerating an already tense relationship, or aggravating an already tense relationship with the Soviet Union. There's another way, another example Cutler gives that I'd never thought of. He said that the invasion of Grenada came directly on the heels of the bombing of the American, the Marine barracks in Beirut. And he said that the television coverage of the bombing of the barracks, and I was there and I know how horrifying those pictures were, that the television pictures left the American public feeling shattered, that it was a terrible blow to the morale of this country. The Grenada invasion had been percolating along in the White House for a while, and the decision to invade was precipitated because the president felt we've got to get people's confidence and morale back, and it was TV that he was reacting to. I think this is happening in Israel now. I think that the debate is being altered by American television. And the politics, the international politics of the Middle East are being altered by what you're seeing on TV now. American people probably never fully understood who the Palestinians are, that they're the people displaced by the creation of the State of Israel. Ironically, when the Palestinian problem or the Palestinian suffering was going on in Arab countries, you never knew about it. But now that the Palestinian uprising has really moved to the West Bank and the territories occupied by Israel, because Israel has a democratic European free press tradition within its limits, we're learning about it. And because it's happening in Israel, we're seeing it on our TV screens. We're getting this vivid glimpse of the Palestinian suffering in the territories. The Palestinians are using the most savvy media techniques. They throw rocks. No firearms have been used. Very smart. Women and children are out there throwing rocks and being pushed around by Israeli soldiers. The Israelis are shooting the rubber bullets. The Israelis are killing the boys in the streets. And it's all a means of manipulating American public opinion. At the same time, we're getting this on the networks, reports of this incredible soul-searching going on in the American Jewish community. And that coverage, too, is altering the terms of the debate. I want to digress quickly, and I know that you usually start with questions about this time, but I want to talk about network economics because I think they're very interesting, and I think that they help you understand who will be the purveyors of news that you get in the future. The networks, you probably know this, but the networks have a declining share of the American television audience. There was once a time, and I think the peak was in 1976, that the three networks had 93% of American homes watching them on a given weeknight. The Nets predicted that they would lose 7% of that in the worst case. They lost 23%. And now it's 70% of American households watch a network program during prime time. It's still a medium fabulously rich. But the network news divisions are facing huge economy drives, cuts in their budget. They are fabulously expensive to run. The typical network news division has about 800 to 1,000 employees. And if you leave out the morning programming and the occasional documentaries, they're giving you 22 minutes of television a day. Their overheads have gotten scandalous. And when Lawrence Tisch bought CBS, one of the first things he said was, how is it the news division overheads have gone from $90 million to $300 million in the space of a decade, and we still do 22 minutes of television every night? And so when you hear the horror stories about the night of the long knives at CBS when they fire 215 people in a space of a few minutes, there was a reason for that. It's that the network news divisions got too big, too bloated, and they're not productive. They are productive, but they don't have an outlet for the stuff they do. The affiliated stations, and in this market, of course, it's K2, KOIN, and KGW, are still very profitable, but that that endless slope of profits upwards is leveling off, and the network affiliates may face a time when their real dollar incomes are declining. Local news is profitable, but it's expensive to do. So in many markets, you only see the network affiliates, because of their relative prosperity, mounting serious news operations. You will probably see, and you have seen in some cities in America, the curtailment of news by some network affiliates, because they can make more money with entertainment. You will see some stations and some markets surrender the 6 o'clock news or a half hour of the 5 o'clock news, whatever they have, to put on something like Silver Spoons. That's what's happened in Seattle. I don't even know what that program is, but that's what's on, and it makes money for them, and it's much less expensive. Down the line, a lot of people see the death of the network news divisions. If they survive it, it will be because they are so key to the prestige of the networks and not because they make any money. And you may know that there was this awful aside that took place at the GE. They had a big management retreat for GE and some dude ranch in Arizona. And this was meant to be private, of course, among the top 30 managers of GE. But the president, whose name I can't remember right now, said, "Well, looking at these numbers, boys, we might have to do without this news division at some point." Well, of course, someone that had been in the meeting ran to a telephone, and it was in the New York press within 24 hours, and that electrified the whole television industry. That's the unspeakable thing. They are too fat and too rich, and they're not making money. What that means to you is that the identity of your local news purveyors may alter. And the time may come when you get your national and international news from KGW and KOIN, with the network in some truncated role, like being a wire service or something like that. And I fear with the loss of seriousness and depth that the foreign bureaus of the networks can give. The good sign is that more and more stations have a presence in Washington, D.C., Washington, D.C. bureaus. And it's given that a reporter employed by KGW can do a much better job of interviewing Denny Smith than any network report. In fact, they'll never get to Denny Smith. But the ominous economic fact remains that when stations replace news with entertainment, they make money. So, for example, in San Francisco is that the ABC affiliate there moved the ABC Network News, the Peter Jennings show, moved it back in half an hour and put Vanna White up against the other networks. And Vanna White is neck and neck with CBS and NBC at 7 o'clock in San Francisco. There's another trend to watch for, which I call bogus news. You may know about the new Morton Downey Jr. show. And as far as I can tell, all he has to peddle is insults and vulgar talk. Geraldo Rivera has a program. I think it's in this market. King Broadcasting probably broadcasts it. I'm not sure. But it is unvarnished sensationalism. There's nothing else to commend it. To some extent, I'm indicting Donahue and Oprah Winfrey for the same reasons. They tackle serious subjects, but they very easily succumb to the lesbian nuns and the person who claims to know a vampire. And they are not serious programs. They cannot claim to be serious programs. They are entertainment programs. They're not news programs. There's a person I disagree with, but I feel obliged to quote him on this. John Corey, who writes for the New York Times, calls this the new dumbness, and he's talking about Morton Downey. Coarse language, shocking pictures, and empty thoughts. But Corey says, this is a way that TV is getting better in an anthropological sense, because it's showing us more and more to ourselves. Well, I think it's the worst possible pandering to our worst instincts. Can TV be good? Of course it can be good, and it is. It often is good. But the paradox of good TV is that it cannot command the wide spectrum audiences that are sought by advertisers. You take a show like Hill Street Blues, which was a surprise to everyone. It succeeded back when NBC was in third place because NBC gambled on that show, and they decided that they would settle not for a blockbuster hit, but for a more narrow, smarter, more affluent share of the market at that time. And they got it. But the point is this, that the audience for quality is very narrow. And the advertiser wants big, broad audiences. And the network that seeks the quality demographic is perforce, is going to have to concede the larger market to its opposition. There's another interesting theme which I don't buy. The networks say, well, we are tackling some difficult issues in our entertainment shows, and they point to things like The Burning Bed, shows about incest, wife battering. But there's an interesting interview in Harper's last year in which a network producer confessed. He said, look, they are reasonably safe issues in the way we treat them, and at the same time we can appeal to people's prurient interest. In other words, it may seem socially responsible, but it's still a variety of pornography as far as I'm concerned. One of the claims for television is the networks is that they bring us together as a nation on great civic moments. That's ending. This year, none of the networks except CNN, which has a limited distribution, will give you gavel-to-gavel coverage of national political conventions. The market has been fragmented, and for that reason, it's felt by the FCC and others that there's no longer the pressure to make the networks do things as there was when they had a virtual monopoly. You follow me? The point is that it was easier for the FCC to say do the conventions when they had 93% of the audience. Now in a fractured marketplace, it's quite different. So if television is taken as your indicator, we are not a unified nation. We are the electronic Balkans in some sense. That's not necessarily bad. I want to emphasize that. But it's a fact you have to deal with when you understand our public life. So what I'm trying to point out is a series of paradoxes. TV can unmask the frauds in public life, and does. But at the same time, it's easily manipulated. And an actor may have an advantage in running for president. Television may put a premium on the wrong qualities when it helps us choose our public officials. At the same time, it can give you penetrating insights into your leadership. At the same time, it can undermine their authority when it reveals their mortality or their body functions. H. Allen Smith, the humorist, who I'm dating myself, but he wrote Life in a Putty Knife Factory and some other wonderful books, said, some performers on television appear to be horrible people, but when you meet them in person, they are even worse. So I think it can give new urgency and new understanding to the foreign affairs debate. But at the same time, it can accelerate the decision-making in very dangerous ways, as it did in the Korean airliner thing. The founding fathers tried to write us a constitution that would keep the competing interests in some kind of rough balance. They never foresaw that a technology would appear that had such ability to enthrall and to manipulate the human mind and the public mind. Television is an industry, I want to remind you again, driven by its economics, and its economics are a function of that ability to manipulate human behavior. Arthur Schlesinger put the paradox of television very nicely, and I'm going to steal this from him. He says, it is a case of multiple personality. One part snapshots of reality, one part commercial manipulation, one part dream factory. Very likely, he says, on balance, TV shakes people up more than it settles them down. It encourages equality more than it does hierarchy, and thereby is generally diversifying and liberating in its social effect. So I would say that in television, what you see is all the energy, the vulgarity, the ebb and flow of power that is American society. It is shaping that debate, and you better keep an eye on it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Compton. Now our question and answer period. As in the past, we have forms on the table if you'd care to submit a written question. However, we give preference to questions from the floor. The first question from our President-elect, Bill Lesh.
Mr. Compton, Ted Koppel in a recent issue of Esquire magazine was bemoaning the fact that he's getting tired of politicians answering his insightful, detailed questions with, as he puts it, the lowest common denominator answers. In view of your comments about talking to many audiences at once through television and forcing consistency on public officials, is there any hope for Mr. Koppel to get something that has a higher denominator to his insightful questions?
Well, you really nail me on that, because the question is, can politicians be have their feet held to the fire in some way? And I think they can. We try to do it Sunday mornings on the Compton Report, and but it's very difficult. And once again, it is the economics of television that drive it. You can't get the 15 minutes that you need, as Koppel does and does masterfully. You can't get that time. And secondly, there's a way they can wiggle out of it. And it's exactly what Mike Dukakis has done this year, and it's probably one of the brilliant master strokes of recent politics. He has managed to not take any positions. Now, that's a gross exaggeration of what he's done, but he has managed to avoid allegiances with labor, with any of the traditional democratic interest groups, and he's managed to sort of keep himself as a nice, agreeable everyman. It's the same way that Booth Gardner ran for governor of Washington State. Don't judge me on my positions. I'm a nice man, and I'm a manager, and you should hire me for my basic competence. You know, take me because I'll just do a good job for you. And that's Dukakis' strategy, and it's working. I can't answer you entirely. I think the sinister thing is the economics of the networks, which is giving them less time, less opportunity to do what Koppel does, and which is to force accountability.
Please identify yourself.
Gregson Parker, City Club member. Mr. Compton, at the beginning of your talk, you credited television with bringing formerly taboo subjects such as incest and homosexuality out of the closet and into the living room. I would like your comments on what to me is a more fundamental and global question than that, specifically with the news and the documentary function of television. Specifically in the lifestyles and the value systems that are represented by both daytime and nighttime soap operas, is television providing a mirror to American society and saying, these are your values, these are your acceptable lifestyles, these are your acceptable mores, or in fact, are they bringing something out of the closet and providing some sanction to that by bringing it into our living room?
But that's a terrific question. I don't know how to measure that, but it's clear to me, you've heard my position, that I think that television is, as Schlesinger calls it, a dream machine, which exists in its huge riches and commercial importance because it can manipulate people's behavior. It can manipulate their expectations. I think it's the latter. That is, I think that the networks are trying to portray lifestyles and consumption patterns that are probably not realistic for most Americans. In other words, the feeling, the belief that everyone can have a fast car and can have a lovely home and can have those sorts of artifacts of prosperity, that's not a realistic expectation for everyone. It is for some people. And what's striking to me, I just attended an economics conference last week in Minneapolis, and the one thing that comes out of survey research about how people feel about their lives, their economic lives these days, is their fear of downward mobility. In other words, everyone feels that they're holding on to a blackboard, you know, or holding on with their claws like this and slipping downward. Well, why is that? Because the statistics contradict that completely. You know, family income went up in the 60s and the 70s. It declined a little under Reagan, but people may not be thriving, but they're certainly not poor in this country. I think it's because television has created those sorts of unrealistic expectations about lifestyle, because you see the dynasty and you see the lives of rich people that that none of us can realistically aspire to.
Thank you. Frank Bungem, City Club member. My question has to do with what I see as perhaps TV covering itself more and more. Someone smart said that TV doesn't tell us what to think, but does tell us what to think about. And to the extent that TV can almost force public policy decisions on issues, I'm wondering if you think that that's becoming more common. For example, I think of the missing kids thing, which was covered and then covered by other people who were perhaps covering the initial coverage. And since those stories were first so present in the headlines, it's come out that, in fact, strangers weren't picking up kids off the street, but there were a lot of custody fights where one parent would take the child away. But in the interim, while that was coming out, there were a lot of pressure to policy changes, funding, allocation, that sort of thing. You think it's more common that TV covers itself rather than actual events?
Well, you're right. There's a morbid fascination with figures in the media that I don't think is very healthy, and it's because of a bias that I have that the newsman is never the news. And that's what's so unhealthy about Geraldo Rivera, is that he's not telling you about the things he goes to see. He's somehow telling you about his adventures or something like that. And I think that that's offensive. I really do. I can't account for the morbid public fascination with the figures in the media. You know, there are as many kiss and tell books about CBS News as there are about the White House now. And the latest one, by Ed Joyce, is an absolutely blood-curdling account of how Dan Rather got him kicked out as president of CBS News. But why don't we know the same things about General Motors or about, Tektronix? I mean, that's not a company of that scale, but there's something that fascinates the public about the figures in the media, and I think the coverage of the media by the media really subverts our purpose, doesn't it? What are we doing that for? But we're doing it.
Dave Jones, City Club member. Jim, thinking about politics, and they used to say that it was the political bosses who selected the candidates. And now it's the assignment editors at the TV stations. So would you comment on this and kind of fill that out a little bit for us?
Well, Dave, there's an even bigger phenomenon, which is the death of political parties, which used to be the ways that citizens mediated their choice of politicians or of public officials. There's a lot of people have written about the death of political parties because of television. It's very clear that a politician today can go directly to the public. He doesn't have to go and be a ward healer, and he doesn't have to go and pass out leaflets in Laurelhurst in order to get into the Democratic Party framework. He just goes and files for office, and it's particularly pernicious in Washington State, where we have a blanket primary. The parties don't have, there's no party discipline whatsoever. I think that it's a fact to be dealt with. I mean, I don't want to take the position that it's bad. I just say it's something that we have to learn to deal with. And the smart people, the people that understand the process best, including the people that in the White House press office, as we know from Leslie Stahl, are the ones that are going to be the leadership in this country.
I have a written question. Please elaborate on the role TV is playing and has the potential to play in the Middle East. Can TV help force Israel to negotiate with the Palestinians? If so, how?
You know, I've thought a lot about that question, and I tried to say in bringing up the Israel question that something is changing. I don't know whether it can shift the debate in this country as far as it would have to bring Israel to the table. I don't really know that. What I can tell you is that Americans, when I was covering the Middle East, people didn't fully appreciate the danger or the potency of the Palestinian issue. And the Israelis, after all, have been giving the Palestinians a lot of grief for a lot of years. And one of the things they did is that there is always a quid pro quo. The Israelis very wisely do what we do not do with terrorist acts, which is that they go, and if somebody throws a hand grenade on a bus, somebody's going to pay for it. There will always be a quid pro quo. That retaliatory act in recent years has tended to be against Palestinian camps. These are refugee camps where the Palestinians live in South Lebanon. And the media couldn't get to them. And the Israelis would routinely, if there was an attack on the northern borders of Israel, the media would go up and show the attack on Kiryat Shemona or whatever the kibbutz was up on the border. And we would then learn that there had been a retaliatory airstrike against a Lebanese or against a Palestinian camp somewhere in Lebanon. And often 30 or 40 people would die. But the media never got there. And equation was never understood in the American public. My point about the Middle East is simply that the cycle of retaliation has to be broken somehow. Who is to say that the attack on Sidon is to retaliate for an attack on northern Israel, or that the attack on northern Israel was to retaliate for the previous attack on Be'er Sheva refugee camp? My point is that we've lost track of the dynamics of that. Who is the aggressor? And the Israelis are committing terrorist acts, in my mind, when you go and you bomb the household of Yasser Arafat in Tunis, which is a sovereign country, using American aircraft. It's pretty hard for me to tell that from somebody who shoots or throws a hand grenade on a bus in the West Bank. It's still violent action meant to alter the political debate. So this is kind of circular, but I guess what I'm getting around to is saying that in the end, the public opinion in this country is changing. Americans now understand that there is a Palestinian problem and that it is immensely dangerous to this country and to the state of Israel. Whether public opinion in this country will be altered in the face of, you know, the American Jewish community is clearly one of the most powerful political action groups that exists anywhere. And they have stood four square not entirely on the activities in the West Bank, but they've stood four square behind Israel in their activities in recent years. It remains to be seen, but television is the key to that outcome, I think.
My question is about quality in television news, particularly local television news, which, as I heard you saying, has tremendous potential for growth in bringing, in improving the debate. What is the potential in local television news departments for higher quality news programming?
Well,
if you will.
It's unlimited, and I think, there are some very good signs. I know that in our newsroom in Seattle, we've hired in the last couple of years two guys with law degrees. That's how attractive it's getting. The important thing is that as local stations look for programming to put into those hours that are theirs, in other words, between whatever it is, 4 and 8 in the evening, it's called local access time. There are no programs out there right now. Oprah Winfrey, The Donahue Show, those programs have become extremely expensive. And the syndicators of those programs are just bandits. They've got guns held to the local stations. What can the local stations do that will make money and that will attract local viewers? They can expand their news programming. And that I think, is the dynamic in a lot of markets right now, is that the expansion of programming, largely for economic reasons, is going to be in the news area. And I think that, you know, we're reinventing television news right now. I think we've seen it in its infancy. We've seen the explosion of the technology. And now, in our newscast, we're finding out what to do with it. You know, we're not going live from City Hall gratuitously anymore. We're doing it for good reasons and trying to figure out what we can do with it. I'm very encouraged by what I'm seeing in local news, but I think it's going to be slow in developing.
We'll take just this one final written question. All appearances on network news by analysts are limited to a few minutes between commercials. Does this and other structural features limit debate to obvious or familiar ideas, excluding radical views that would require explanation and elaboration since they are radical? Does TV structure allow for broad debate on the issues?
What a good question. That's exactly the problem. That, first of all, the people that you see time after time, they have become predictable, I think. I mean, when there's a presidential press conference, and it's usually when they have time to fill, they have to get till 6:30, and the press conference ends at 6:20. Who do you get? Well, you get John Chancellor, whom I admire. You get Brokaw, but you don't. The problem is there's no diversity to that opinion, and they are predictable, and they do represent a pretty mainstream political point of view. We, on the program that we do in Seattle and that plays here, try to break that mold a little bit, but it's very difficult, you know. People, I do believe, though, that people have an appetite for much more startling opinions than they get right now. I think that people have a huge appetite for explanation, for background, that the networks don't give you. The networks, because of the time restraints and because of the money issues, simply can't give you any kind of novel or penetrating insight. The one last week, the summit was coming up. We put a guy on the program that I thought was tremendously revealing. His name is William Arkin, who wrote a book called Nuclear Battlefields, which is about the dynamics of nuclear weaponry worldwide. And he was explaining the way that the military establishments of various countries really alter the arms debate, and convinced us that, he said, Ronald Reagan has done something no president ever dared to do, which is to ignore his experts and go ahead and make a deal anyway. Well, William Arkin doesn't appear on NBC because he's considered a bit left or a bit weird. At the same time, we had Howard Phillips, who was from the American Conservative Union, taking, you know, extreme right-wing position, taking the position that Ronald Reagan has betrayed the American people in making an arms deal. Well, I don't know who asked the question, but I think that you're right. Those kinds of non-mainstream views tend to be very, very revealing, and you don't get them from the networks.
Thanks very much, John Compton, for those very incisive and thoughtful remarks. We are adjourned. Thank you.